We start tonight with the Prime Minister's visit to New York and her first official one-on-one with US President Donald Trump. It's part of a high-stakes day of diplomacy for Jacinda Ardern. Let's look at her New York diary. Our Prime Minister's first meeting of the day is with her UK counterpart, Boris Johnson. She's then the opening speaker at the leaders' all-in session on climate change. After that, she'll shift focus to the Christchurch call and talk about how to target online hate in one-on-one meetings with tech bosses, including Facebook's Sheryl Sandberg. Next, a working lunch. She'll give the keynote address at the Secretary General's Forum for the Private Sector. Then the big one, her first official meeting with US President Donald Trump. 20 minutes there. And a one-on-one with Jordan's leader, King Abdullah II. After that, it's back to the Christchurch call, a 90-minute session with country leaders, then a joint press conference with Sheryl Sandberg, and a round table with all of the tech giants. So a little bit of a big day. Earlier today, the Prime Minister talked to reporters about what she's hoping to get out of her chat with Donald Trump.
So this will be a chance for us to continue a conversation that actually the Deputy Prime Minister started some time ago. There has been interest in talking about a free trade agreement with New Zealand, and that's a conversation I'll continue.
So will she make any progress on that trade deal? I'm joined now by former Ambassador to the US and former National Trade Minister Tim Groser and Laila Harre, a former MP and trade unionist. Thank you both very much for being here tonight. Tim Groser, I want to start off with you. You've been involved in hundreds of these bilaterals. We'll call it that for now and come back to that later. But why does President Trump want to meet with Jacinda Ardern now?
Well, I mean, the real danger in most of these is that they're over-scripted, over-engineered by officials. I think with President Trump, there is zero danger of that occurring. So I think she's got to be on her toes to respond to the directions that they have. It's only... what they said, 20 minutes. I would urge her, if I was giving advice directly, to stick to just one or two simple, high-level political messages.
Is that trade, do you think?
Well, if I was asked my own view, I'd say two issues come to front of mind. One is this absolute crisis facing us between the larger Shiite power, Iran, and the centre of the Sunni religion in Saudi Arabia. This is a fight that's been going on for 1,400 years. It's now lethally dangerous. And while we could debate, you know, how this got a lot worse, I mean, the US critics of the president, of course, point to the withdrawal from the Iran nuclear deal. My own view on this is when it comes to what the United States should do now, Trump is actually on the right side of this debate, urging relative caution. He's committed some defensive resources to defense against what we all presume is Iranian proxy efforts to destabilize Saudi. So I think she should cover that off, especially if she's going to meet King Abdullah later on. And then she should do exactly what we've just seen her do, talk about the trade issue. Yeah.
Laila, do you think it's a difficult and delicate situation for the Prime Minister? Does she have to be careful cozying up to Donald Trump, in your opinion?
Well, she won't be cozying up to him, not in a 20-minute meeting, and not given the huge disparity in political opinion, and not just kind of party political opinion, but the orientation of the US administration and the New Zealand government, and I would say Parliament, is, you know, completely at odds. And so one wouldn't expect cozying up. I would have thought that the sort of key issue that she has an obligation to raise, not just as New Zealand's Prime Minister, but as an important leader in the Pacific, is the US's withdrawal from the Paris Agreement. We're also heading in tomorrow to the climate change summit that's been called by the Secretary General of the UN. So it would seem to me that if there was going to be a difficult issue raised, the issue has to be the US's position on climate, and there has to be a clear message on the behalf of the Pacific. I would expect that she will do the ritualistic New Zealand Prime Minister's thing around raising a free trade agreement, but I'd also be disappointed by that. I mean, both Labor and New Zealand First opposed the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement in the form that it was negotiated when the US was part of the negotiations. We already know from Trump and from the renegotiation of the Canada-Mexico-US agreement that if we were to go into negotiations with the US for an FTA, that not only would all the things that were suspended in the TPP come back into play, but Trump has made it clear there would be more too. So it's either disingenuous of her to put a free trade agreement on the agenda with this president, or it's worse.
I want to draw on your expertise on this. The phrase bilateral was used when they put out the press release about from our end, from the New Zealand end. The US media are referring to it as a pull-aside. Mm. Can you just explain the difference and whether it matters and whether this is still a win? Because it's no White House visit, is it?
Well, it's no White House, but look, there are approximately 200 countries in the world that are members of the UN. Everybody wants to get their face time with the US president, and I think it's really good for New Zealand, even if it's very brief, that she does have this meeting. And I think she can register some simple, high-level political points. It is, you know, as Anthony Bourdain would say, a good thing by definition.
Do you think it's a good thing by definition?
I think it's a non-thing. There is a ritualistic meeting between the two of them. They've already met on multiple occasions.
But she's not going to change his mind on climate change, is she?
No, but what should be the message that gets through to the US administration from a key Pacific leader at this time? I mean, there is no more important issue right now in front of the UN as a multilateral body. He's fronting up at the UN, which, you know, is sometimes doubtful in terms of Trump's orientation towards multilateralism. I can't think of a more important issue for her to raise and to put on the record. And, you know, I'd be really worried if we were pursuing a free trade agreement at this time with this administration.
And you'd obviously disagree with that point?
Well, I've been working literally for 30 years trying to achieve this objective, starting off when I was foreign policy advisor to David Longy back in the mid-1980s. So you can hardly expect me to change position. Now, of course, I think we should be pursuing it. However, there is some validity to some of... I mean, I know that you're coming from a completely different perspective on trade generally, but in terms of the specifics you mentioned, there is some validity to what Leila's saying here. The government on our side has to be very clear about what would be involved in an FTA, and equally the United States has to be clear about what it's prepared to offer in exchange. I mean, when I was ambassador, the Americans were saying basically, we could have an FTA provided you excluded our most competitive exports. Well, I think that was either them thinking we were completely crazy or, more likely, a very sophisticated way of saying no. The situation, I think, has evolved a bit since then, which I think is very positive, and I think there's nothing to be... I think there's a lot to be gained by just registering the point that this long-standing New Zealand position that both successive Labour-led and successive National-led governments have pursued is, from our perspective, on the table.
It's hard not to compare what Scott Morrison has been dealt by President Trump. He got the greeting at the White House. He's flying to Ohio to meet with him. I mean, our relationship is we get a little pull aside. It's not much of a comparison, is it?
Well, as I said before, you've got to be realistic in this. I mean, the Australia is an economy which is about nine times our size, is a much more significant asset to the United States than New Zealand. I think the fact she's getting any meeting at all is itself something to be celebrated.
Well, and I would have thought, actually, on the contrary, that from a domestic politics point of view, which will be at the front of the Prime Minister's mind in setting up these engagements or agreeing to these engagements, that it would be very low on her agenda to be invited to or feted at the White House at this time, and would likely lead to all sorts of complicated, difficult conversations.
Do you think she'd go, or do you think she should go?
Well, I don't know what the kind of the protocol is around this, but I think it would be a very sort of cruel move to issue her an invitation and for her Deputy Prime Minister, Minister of Foreign Affairs to hunt for an invitation to the White House would not be doing her a service.
Because diplomatically she couldn't say no, could she? That would be a big win for New Zealand.
Well, of course.
Yeah, and she would go and be welcomed there if that was how it played out, and that's what she's aiming for.
Absolutely, and I mean, let's not forget there have been some very important countries whose leaders have had meetings with the president the last 2 years that haven't been all sunshine, and I mean, I think she would have no political option but to accept if the invitation was offered, and we should accept that.
And we'll have to see if it's all sunshine tomorrow morning, but thank you both very much for your time on that tonight. I really appreciate it.